Hello, my friends. I am so excited to be here today. I'm going to give everybody a minute just to kind of get settled in. We are live. I have a big red box around me, which means I am live and talking to all of you today. So I am overjoyed to be here because we're going to have so much fun. I see people from all over the place. I see people from South Carolina, Ottawa, we have Seattle. Where else are we from here? Seattle, Washington, Langley, BC, Canada. Little secret, I am joining you today from Ontario, Canada. So hello to my American and Canadian friends. I think I saw somebody from England who's joining in. We have so many amazing people here. Nottingham, England, hello from my fourth graders. Hello to Mercer Island, Seattle, Washington State. Ms. Thompson's class checking in from Richmond Hill. Oh my goodness, Iowa, Baldwin Academy in California. Oh my goodness, Orono, Royal Oak. I could just keep naming places. Let's just name places the whole time. This is fantastic. I am so, so, so happy to be here with you today. So I wanted to give you a really quick rundown of exactly what we're going to be doing. So you could just kind of take a big deep breath and take a load off and enjoy your time today, because it is going to be so amazing, so pain-free. You can just relax and enjoy and chat with me. What we're going to do is I am going to introduce myself. I'll do that in just a second. We are going to have a very, very cool chat about animals and science and writing and creativity. Then we are going to have a chance to take a selfie together. And don't worry, I'm going to give you lots of time to get that together. And then you're going to flip into a Q&A. But I do want to mention, if you happen to be taking pictures of our time together before the selfie, which you're absolutely welcome to do, make sure you tag our friends at Flipgrid and use the hashtag FlipgridForAll. And you can even tag Scholastic at @Scholastic. And if you want, you can tag me. I'm on Twitter at @Jess_Keating. So if you want to tag us all there, we can all kind of hang out together and show off that we're hanging out together and having fun. So are you ready, my friends? Okay, I'm going to start off with a very quick introduction into who I am. My name, you may or may not know, is Jess Keating. And it sounds like I'm kind of saying just kidding, doesn't it? Which is kind of funny because it's actually the way I like to approach my life and my writing a lot of the time. I love joking around. I love finding the humor in situations. And what I'm going to do today is take you through some amazing creative lessons that you can learn from animals. Now, you might be wondering, well, why animals, Jess? So guess what? Before I became an author and an illustrator, I was actually a zoologist. Okay, so that is somebody who studies animals. And because I know we have a lot of people watching today who love science and art and writing, I want you to know that you can put your questions in anytime into the chat box. We're not going to be able to get to questions until a little bit later, but you can use that little box on the right, and then my lovely friends at Scholastic and Flipgrid are going to go through and make sure that they are front and center for my attention. So if you have questions about anything we talk about today, but specifically about things like writing or animals or creativity or drawing, I would love to hear from you. Alrighty? So that is how you can help me, and I'm going to help you now. So like I said, let's take one more big, deep, deep, deep breath together because we're having fun. Take it in and then let it out. I love to do that because it means that you don't have to do any work right now. You just get to listen to me chat. So are you ready for a creative lesson from our very first animal? Now, I will warn you, this animal can sometimes make people feel, how do we say, a little squeamish. So if you are a fan of creepy or maybe gross or maybe disgusting animals, this one is for you. So here we go. Our very first animal I'm going to show you very, very quickly is this fella. Ba, 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 ba. It does not look like much, right? But as you can see, this is a dung beetle. And if you are at all familiar with dung beetles, you know what they eat. Who can guess what dung beetles eat? I'll give you a few moments to put into the chat. What do we think dung beetles actually eat? And we have some guesses already. So I will tell you, dung beetles actually eat poop. I know, It's pretty disgusting. You can tell they're not much to look at, right? But in this picture here, this here is the dung beetle, and all of this here is elephant poop. Elephant poop. So what on earth can we learn from the dung beetle, right? Well, my friends, the dung beetle is a very excellent lesson in embracing what you love. And yes, that is going to sound a little weird because in the case of the dung beetle, we are talking about poop. But get this, the dung beetle actually survives its entire life on poop. And what it will do is it will go sneak up behind an elephant or an animal, like an antelope or a gazelle. It will wait for it to poop, and then it will grab a little pile of that poop and drag it where it needs to be to its own little dung beetle home, right? So I know that this can sound really kind of gross, right? And it is gross. We don't want to be doing that. But I do want you to think about the fact that an animal can spend its whole life basically surrounded by something that doesn't really look cool to you, right? Like, we don't want to spend our lives like that. But the neat thing about dung beetles is they show us that we can embrace what works for us, okay? So this is something that I think is so important because I know you have so many, we have so many readers out there and so many writers and so many artists and so many scientists. Whatever makes you light up from the inside is a great thing. And sometimes we can almost feel a little bit afraid to share what we love, right? Because we know that it might look weird. And I have to tell you, when I was younger, I know we have students joining us from all over the place, from so many different ages. When I was younger and about your age, I used to feel really scared and self-conscious to share what I loved. I loved animals, and I loved animals like this from this book, Gross as a Snot Otter, that were so weird and disgusting and gross to other kids. But guess what? It is okay to share what you love and embrace all the things about you that make you feel a little weird. In fact, as we're talking right now, I would love for you to put into the chat box, when you grow up, how do you feel you would like to become as a person who shares your ideas? Would you like to be a scientist? Would you like to be an artist? Somebody who draws pictures or comics, maybe? Would you like to be an author? Somebody who tells stories like that? I would love to know. And when we get to our final animal, I'm going to bring all of that back in here, okay? So we have, we have so many people who are enchanted with the idea of poop. So that is our first animal, all right? We have a lesson from the dung beetle, which is, it is okay to embrace what you love, no matter what it is, because what you love is actually the stuff that will turn you into an amazing, incredible human with incredible stories to tell, all right? So that is our first animal. Are you ready for our second animal? Now, this animal comes courtesy of a book called What Makes a Monster, which is all about the world's scariest animals. But of course, with scary animals, we have to remember that sometimes reputations are not always true. So this is the case for one of these animals. Now, this guy is not so scary, but it is a little bit strange. So I'll give you a moment to take a look at him. This is the horror frog, also known as the Wolverine frog. And you might notice here, he looks a little bit like a particular X-Men, right? Have you ever heard of the X-Men Wolverine? I bet you have. So Wolverine was actually one of my favorite characters of the X-Men because Wolverine could do this incredible thing, right? He had these claws, these adamantium claws that shot out of his hands. But guess what? The Wolverine frog can do exactly that. So get this. Normally when frogs get scared, like you've probably encountered a frog in your life before, right? What do they do when they get scared? They just sort of hop, hop, hop away, and they might say, you know, ribbit or something like that. But this frog, the Wolverine frog, when they are scared, they actually go like, ah, and they break the bones inside of their little froggy hands, and those bones shoot out like this. like bone claws. Oh my gosh, right? This is an actual animal who can do something that I would call a superpower. Like, this is stuff that if a human could do that, we would literally call them a superhero, but these animals can just do that almost magically. How incredible is that? So I want you to ask yourself, what is a creative lesson that we could learn from the Wolverine frog, right? So from the dung beetle, we've learned that it's okay to embrace what makes you weird because that's what makes you so unique and special, right? We've learned that from the dung beetle. But what on earth could we learn from the Wolverine frog? What do we have inside of us that makes us unique and special? Well, get this, my friends. Everything inside of you makes you unique and special. And I want you to know when you are working on anything you're working on, whether you're writing a story or drawing a picture or putting on your scientist caps and exploring the world, you have everything you need to do what you want to do, okay? You do not need a fancy notebook to be an author. You do not need to be somebody's, you know, super, super smart or amazing, getting all the best grades to be an incredible scientist. Everything you are already inside of you is all you need. So your superpowers are all of the things that you love about yourself. They're all of the things that you work really hard on. Like I know I saw here before, we have lots of authors, we have actors, we have Aiden wants to be a scientist. We have people who want to be an artist, a vet, and a YouTuber. We have lawyers. We have all sorts of people with amazing, amazing talents. And the neat thing is you can do all of it, my friends, okay? You have everything you need. Just like the Wolverine frog, you have superpowers yourself, which I think is just incredible. In fact, you know what? Oh, I see we have people who want to be shoe designers. Oh my goodness. We have doctors, we have biologists. Ileana wants to be an artist. We have scientists in the mix. Oh my goodness. So what I'm going to ask you now, because I'm loving this, I think this is fantastic. What is something about you that you think is really special, right? If you were a horror frog or a Wolverine frog, you would say your claws are your superpower. But what is your superpower? Okay, and I'm going to start. I will start with one of mine. I think, just in this example, my superpower is that I'm very, very curious, right? And lots of you I know are very curious too. I love exploring the world and asking questions. And the neat thing about being a scientist and a zoologist is that is a big part of your job. You can just ask questions all day long and try to find the answers. So let's see, what other superpowers do you think you have? Do you like to bake? Do you like to ask lots of questions like me? Do you like to draw? Do you like to explore the world? Maybe your superpower is that you're a really good friend. And all of those aspects that make you a good friend can also make you a really excellent scientist or a really excellent artist. Oh my goodness, we have so many people chiming in. I'd like to be an ornithologist. Oh, we have somebody who has an excellent running ability. That is an incredible superpower. You know, you share that superpower with a cheetah. That is special. What else? I want to work in a stock market. Oh, I love that. We have a superpower here that I am confident. Oh my goodness, that is amazing. To be able to say, I am confident in who I am, that is exactly what we were talking about with the dung beetle, right? To embrace what makes us us and what we love about ourselves. That is incredible. What else do we have? Oh, somebody wants to be a Lego creator. I love it. Somebody's good at drag racing. What, somebody in the second grade, I believe, says that their imagination is their superpower. Oh my goodness. You know what you can do with a big imagination is you can write amazing stories. And that's actually a really, really good lead-in to our next animal. This is our final animal. So I know I asked you earlier, particularly about who wanted to be a scientist, who wanted to be an author, and who wanted to draw pictures, right? But it was a bit of a trick because the truth is you can do all of that and more. So when I was your age, one of the most frustrating and annoying questions that I ever got from a grown-up was, what do you want to be when you grow up? And I know I just asked you that, but hang in here with me. What bothered me about that question is that it kind of made me feel like I could only pick one of those things. And some people, they know one thing that they really, really want to do with their lives. But some people aren't like that. I was not like that. I wanted to be an artist. I wanted to be a scientist. I wanted to be an author. I wanted to explore the world, right? And I want you to know that you can do all of those things. And the animal that I want to share with you right now, our very last animal before we have our selfie and our question time, our very last animal is actually an imaginary animal. And I know this is strange because as a zoologist, somebody who studies animals, you know, we've seen an animal from this book and we've seen an animal from this book. I have many, many books about real life animals. But the animal that I'm sharing with you today is one that I created from my own imagination. And that is this little creature right here. This is Bun Bun. And Bun Bun is best friends with Bon Bon. And as you can see, Bun Bun is a talking bunny. And Bun Bun's best friend is Bon Bon, a talking candy. Now, I know it seems strange, but in the spirit of taking on our dung beetle confidence, I wanted to share this book because the truth is I was very, very afraid to put this book out into the world. This Bun Bun and Bon Bon series was actually the 13th book that I wrote. I wrote 13 books before I was brave enough and confident enough to share my imaginary stories, my imaginary creatures that I'd made up. And I don't want you to be afraid of sharing what matters to you. Okay, so whether we have people in here, yeah, we want to be, Marcello wants to be a cop. I guess my superpower is good intuition. I love that. Whatever you want to be, first of all, you can do that. I promise you. Like the Wolverine frog, you have everything you need to accomplish your dreams. But the second thing is, my friends, you don't have to pick. If you feel like, oh gosh, Jess, in my heart, I want to be a baker and a fireman and an expert athlete and a YouTuber and a zookeeper, like I'm pulling from your thoughts here, I want to be a cardiothoracic surgeon. You can do all of those things. And if anybody ever tells you, you can't, you know what that means? That just means that that is true for them. It doesn't mean it's true for you, okay? So that is what I wanted to convey with this little Bun Bun here, because I want you to know that even if you're meeting an author, like you might think, oh, Jess Keating, she's written so many books. She's just, it's easy for her, but it's not. So if you feel like you're self-conscious or you're afraid to share what's inside of you, I want you to know that you don't need to be afraid. But if you do feel that way, it is totally normal, right? Every single author I know is afraid to share what they do because it's a scary feeling. So like I said, whether you're a surgeon or a YouTuber, Jordan, I've always wanted to teach. We have so many people here. I want to be a tester for beta Minecraft. No matter what you want to be, you do not have to pick, okay? So I will take one last quick look here. Let's name some of the amazing things you're going to be doing with your lives. Professional driver one day and do races from Geo at Baldwin Academy. We have bakers. I want to be an expert in astrophysics. Oh my goodness. I want to be a singer and songwriter from Alexandria. That is a wonderful, wonderful thing to do with your life. Angie wants to be a hairstylist. Oh my gosh. So my friends, I hope this is so inspiring to you. But now we get to a fun part. This is our little halfway point here. We are going to take a selfie because I know we have lots of questions coming up. I'm going to put this little selfie moment in a bit earlier because we're having so much fun. So I'm going to say, teachers and parents, now is your time to do your shuffle around. I'm going to give you a few seconds here. And what we will do is we will give you probably 30 seconds. We're going to get into a pose and we'll take maybe a couple poses. And then if you want to share those selfies, you want to use the hashtag Flipgrid for all, and you want to tag our friends at Scholastic. You want to tag our friends at Flipgrid, and you can also tag me. I am at Jess_Keating. So have we maybe got ourselves situated here? Let's take one more big deep breath. Get our best smiling faces on. Okay, so here we go. We will do one pose. We'll do this, and I will give you 10 seconds. Let's take 10 or so seconds. Okay, here we go. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Doesn't that feel weird? It feels so weird when you're already in position. Let's take one more. Let's grab a couple other books here. Okay, here we go. We'll do this. Oh my goodness. Are you ready? Here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. Ugh. It does feel very strange, but that's okay. We are embracing what makes us strange, and today that is posing for a really, really, really long time. Okay, so now, my friends, I think we are now at the best part. We are at exactly 1:21. So what we are going to be doing now is sharing some questions. So thankfully, my amazing friends at Flipgrid and Scholastic have been helping me put all your amazing questions together, and I'm going to go through them as much as we can today. So our first question, are you ready? Everybody, you can kind of get settled back in. I'll give you a few moments because you probably had to shuffle a bit. I'll shuffle around myself while you're doing that. Okay, big deep breaths and out. All right, our first question from Samantha at Baldwin Academy. How do some animals regrow their body parts? Oh my gosh, Samantha, that is an amazing question. And I think I have a book back there called Cute as an Axolotl, and that might be what you are referencing, my friend Samantha. So axolotls, you've probably heard of lizards before that can lose their tails and then they can go on and survive without their tail. And sometimes you can even see their tail kind of like moving after it's off their body, which is like, disgusting. But the neat thing about axolotls is they can not only regrow their tails, but they can also regrow their limbs, like their hands and their feet, and they can even regrow parts of their brain, which is, again, if a human could do that, that would be a superhero, right? I think Wolverine can kind of do that. I think if Wolverine gets hurt, you know, Wolverine can heal his body like that. That X-Men can do that. But the axolotl can do that. And the way they do that is they have very, very special cells in their body, which can become anything. So this is interesting because right now, when you're born or when you're being incubated, when you're developing in your mother's womb, you have cells that will tell your fingernails. So everybody kind of grab your fingernails here, right? Those cells already know that they are going to become fingernails, okay? And you have cells that know they are going to become your earlobes, and cells that know they're going to become your eyes. You have cells that will become your hair and your skin. But with an axolotl is, they have special cells that can become many, many different things. So that is how they're able to regrow different parts. Because if something gets hurt, if they lose, you know, a finger or something, they can regrow those parts because the cells have the instructions to rebuild that piece of their body. So that's an excellent question, Samantha. Okay, what do we got? Mrs. Yaz's fourth and fifth graders, what made you change from being a zoologist to a writer? Oh my goodness, I could talk about it. How long do we have? I could talk about this for hours. I won't. But what made me become a writer after being a zoologist for so long was because I was learning so many amazing facts about animals and about the world. And the neat thing that happens when you learn so, so much about the world, you start to see how beautiful everything is. We had a comment in here earlier that they thought that the dung beetle was actually probably helping the ecosystem by eating poop. And you, my friend, are exactly right. But guess what? The whole world is like that. Every animal kind of works like this together. It's a whole big, beautiful system. And the more time I was learning about how incredible this world was, the more I wanted to share it with other people. Because to me, having amazing knowledge and facts and stories and perspectives, it isn't really fun if you're not sharing it, right? Like, you've probably experienced this before, where say you read an amazing book, you know, you don't want to hoard that to yourself, you want to share it with others. So that is why I became an author and an illustrator, as well as a zoologist. That is a wonderful question. Okay, what inspired you to start writing books? Another excellent question from Miss Stewart's fourth grade class. Hello, my friends. So what inspired me to write books was the fact that I, as I mentioned, I was learning so much about amazing things and I wanted to share it. But what really helped me remember that I could share it was seeing other people like me becoming authors. So when I was very, very young, I didn't have a chance to meet a lot of authors in person or ever. Like, we didn't have the internet. I've just aged myself, but we didn't have the internet when I was very, very young. So my only experience with authors was that they were just sort of names, you know, on a book cover. I didn't really think of them as people sitting down and writing. But when I was about 10 or 11 years old, I actually went to a writing conference for actual human living amazing authors. And I met some incredible women there who really inspired me. And I thought, you know what? If they can do that, I bet you I can do that too. So that is why I ultimately got more into writing. That's a wonderful question. Okay, Ruby wants to know, how does something that small like the dung beetle not get squished by the animals it is trying to steal poo from? Ruby, that is amazing. And I have to say, I don't know that scientists have ever actually looked at that question. And I can tell you, Ruby, by the fact that you've asked that question, you have a scientist in your heart. You might also be an author or an illustrator or an artist or anything else that you imagine, but my dear Ruby, you have a scientist heart as well, because that is a wonderful question. I would imagine that sometimes they actually do get squished, but I don't think it would happen very often. And here is my guess. So this is my hypothesis. And if you're not familiar, a hypothesis is a guess that is kind of educated. So I'm making a bit of an educated estimate of why I think this would happen. So what happens when elephants walk on the ground? What do you think happens? We can hear that, right? But I bet you we can also feel those vibrations on the ground, because elephants are so heavy. So I bet you what they do, Ruby, is the dung beetles can sense the ground moving when elephants are nearby, and I bet you they just skedaddle right out of there. That is my guess, but we would have to probably ask a scientist who works with dung beetles, but I still don't think they've ever looked at that question. So that is, you get points for that one, Ruby. That is incredible. Okay, Ms. Villalobos, fourth grade class, how do you choose a topic for a book? Oh, my friends, it is so hard to choose a topic, not because I don't have lots of ideas, but because they all compete with each other. I'm very fortunate that I get to write lots of books. I have the fifth book in this World of Weird Animals series coming out this fall. I have the fifth book in the series coming out, and it means I get to talk about lots of different animals. But I'll tell you, I often feel guilty because every time I'm writing a book like this, I have about 50 animals that I want to tell you guys about, you lovely guys and gals. I want to tell everybody about all these animals in my head. But in these books in particular, I only have room for 17, which means I have to leave a lot of animals out. So I actually feel kind of guilty when I do that. So what happens then is I just think, okay, I have to write another book. So that is how I pick topics. I pick things that feel really important for me to tell you all about, because I know they are so, so amazing and inspiring. That's an excellent question. What do we have here next? Oh, I love this from Mrs. Yaz's fourth and fifth graders. Is there any animal or insect that scares you? So I know lots of people are afraid of sharks. I love sharks. Lots of people are afraid of spiders and snakes. I love spiders and snakes. Do you want to know the one animal that scares me? I'll tell you, it's a secret. Humans. Humans terrify me sometimes, because we can be amazing, wonderful creatures, but we can also be really scary. Humans don't treat the world the way they should sometimes. You know, humans litter sometimes. Humans put garbage in the ocean. Humans might, you know, tear down or log a rainforest. Those are terrible, terrible things. So even though I think humans have amazing abilities and capacities, I think it is really important that we all work together to make sure that we use our powers and our superpowers for good. So yes, humans scare me, but only the ones who don't treat the earth with respect, which is not you fine people. You're here today because you know how important science and conservation is. I love that. Tamming at Baldwin Academy, do cats actually have 9 lives? You know what? I don't believe they actually have 9 lives, but the cool thing about cats is they do really seem to be incredibly, what's the word, flexible in their ability to survive. I had a cat once growing up that was actually hit by a car, which was horrible, but it survived. And I know lots of people that have stories like this about their cats that were just, oh yeah, the cat's deaf and blind and can't eat and it's still just fine. So I don't know if there's actually scientific proof that they have 9 lives, but they are very, very, very adaptable, which is a word that means they're able to handle all sorts of different circumstances. And I think that that helps them appear a little bit magical. That's a good question. Okay. And Naya, what is your favorite animal? Oh my goodness. So Naya, my favorite animal is the wolf. And I bet you, let's put in the chat here, if your favorite animal is also the wolf, I would love to see that. Because you know what? We've talked a lot about animals that have different reputations, you know, some scary animals and sharks maybe having some scary reputations. But of all the animals on this planet, wolves are the most misunderstood. And it's probably because we have stories like the big bad wolf, you know, in Little Red Riding Hood, or the wolf that blows down, who's the three little pigs, right? The wolf comes along and blows down the house. So because of these stories, we have all of these feelings about wolves that just aren't true. They aren't based in reality. So we have lots of people that don't think that wolves should be on our planet because they're so scary. But that really bothers me because wolves are incredible creatures and they're actually what is known as a keystone species, which means basically it's a fancy word for they are very, very important. And if you remove wolves from an ecosystem, the whole ecosystem collapses and falls down. So I've always loved wolves. They have always been my favorite animal. Excellent question, my dear. What does a shark eat? Lincoln, oh my goodness. A shark eats whatever it wants, basically. There are so many different types of sharks. There are sharks that are literally this big, about 7 inches long. They would fit in the palm of my hand. That would be a dwarf lantern shark. That is the smallest shark in the world. But there are also sharks that are so, so, so big, 40 feet long sharks. And the funny thing is, the bigger sharks, like the whale shark, they don't actually eat big things, they eat small things. So if you wanna know what a shark eats, it depends, my friend, on what kind of shark it is. Okay, we have 2 more questions, and I want you to know, if I don't get to your questions, because I know you have so many and it's so amazing, you can still tag me on Twitter, just get your teacher to go online, find me on Twitter at Jess_Keating, and I will answer more questions there anytime you want. It can be today, it can be next week, doesn't matter. I'm happy to answer your questions and I love hearing from you. So let's pick our last 2 questions. Do you think, this is from the grade 3s at Langley Meadows, do you think there are more marine animals we haven't discovered yet? Oh, my friends, yes. I fully believe there are incredible marine animals we haven't discovered yet, and I also think there are animals that live on land that we haven't discovered yet. And the neat thing about marine animals is there is so much ocean out there. I heard recently that we actually know more about space, outer space, than we do about our own oceans. So think about the exciting discoveries there of what we might find. Right? There's probably lots of people here who want to grow up and become marine biologists. My friends, it is on you to discover these animals. Okay, our very, very last question. Does the Wolverine frog have to heal after its bones break? This is amazing. So you know how the X-Men, the Wolverine guy, he actually has healing powers? It appears as though Wolverine frogs are able to heal their skin after they do their little bone claw move, which is incredible. That is an incredible, incredible question from Davidson Road, grade 3. You are all scientists, my friend. Okay, so we have had our little creative lesson about animals and what we can learn from them regarding our own voices and our own creativity. We've had our selfie moment. We have had our question and answer. And now all that remains, my friends, is first of all, to give yourselves a round of applause. You're all muted, so you can't do it, but I will do it for you. But I want you to know this conversation can continue as much as you want. If you head over to the Flipgrid Discovery Library, we have put together so many amazing resources for you, and we would love to see what you do with all of the fun stuff we talked about today, okay? And remember, if you're tweeting about this event that we had together or our time together, or you're sharing it anywhere on social media, tag us. I would love to see what you're doing. I would love to see your pictures. Tag Flipgrid, tag Scholastic, and tag me. You can find all our information here. We'll put that in the chat box for you. And use the hashtag Flipgrid for all. So again, hop on over now to the Flipgrid Discovery Library. You'll have an amazing time. But most of all, thank you for joining me. I know we are all over the world right now in so many different time zones. I had an amazing, amazing time, and I think you are just incredible. I cannot wait to see what you do with all of your amazing stories and thoughts and all your scientist amazing questions. Okay, my friends, I will take care from there, and I hope you have an amazing rest of your day. Goodbye.